Thank you very much, Dr. Mohammed, and for all the audience. I just was thinking that I know all of you by name, but you know, now I have a face attached to that name because we saw your name, all your requests, and then the reports we send you back. But now we have, today we have.
Did you see the name?
Okay, let's talk about the endovascular options in critical ischemia. Some of these slides might be repetitive because of the previous speakers, so I've just skipped through them. It is interesting to know that CLI was actually when first used in 85, was used for major threat to limb because of chronic ischemia, excluding diabetes. It's very interesting that diabetes was not part of the initial definition of CLI, and now diabetes has become an integral part of the CLI definition. It varies from breast pain to ulceration to gangrene, and is all spectrum. It's the whole spectrum from just breast pain to gangrene, leading to drastic surgical intervention, is part of that spectrum. We talk about burden of the disease, about 100 to 200 per 100,000 patients per year above 65 are part of this disease. More predominantly involves the below inguinal femoral popliteal and tibial disease. But you have to remember one thing that Dr. Paris also mentioned, that CLI is a multi-level disease. If you have a CLI, you have to look for at least more than one level of disease. It's quite possible it may be iliac and distal disease. It's quite possible it have SFA and distal disease. And it's quite possible it has just below knee anatomical disease. It's a small vessel disease, which you cannot image or see. So it's a multi-level disease, and it needs multi-level intervention also. But remember, CLI is CLI is CLI. If you have a CLI, that needs to be managed as soon as possible because there is always a threat to the limb and impending limb loss. Although conservative treatment of CLI can save patients, and studies have shown that there's a 57% limb salvage at 1 year with optimal conservative therapy by wound management, by blood glucose management, by infection management, by statins, but that may not be very prolonged, because if you look at this figure, this is a very famous slide, it's shown everywhere else, that even after initial treatment in either endovascular or surgical with CLI, after 6 months only, 20% of the patient would have died anyway. 35% would be alive with amputation, and 45% will be alive without amputation. This just reflects that CLI, when it's manifest itself, is not only a mild disease, it's a late manifestation of a diffuse, multi-system, multi-organ vascular disease. And predominantly of the patient who died within 6 months had died of cardiovascular disease, because if you have a damaged or diseased posterior tibial artery, this patient might always will have a damaged LAD or damaged coronary carotid arteries. So you have to identify the disease as soon as possible to be treated as early as possible to avoid the definitive treatment of amputation, which used to be the treatment of choice for centuries. So as I mentioned, it's a multi-level disease. So first of all, you have to improve the inflow. The aortoiliac disease can be stenotic or can be occlusive, and you can do balloon angioplasties. Balloon angioplasty used to be the initial treatment in iliac disease, but now people have gone more towards stent placement because of their durability. Although the part is left, aorto bifemoral bypass has good patency rate overall, but a lot of surgeons, especially the great surgeon Dave Dachweck, once said that in 21st century, doing the aorto bypass for segmental iliac occlusion might be criminal, because the stenting, the percutaneous intervention has a comparable patency rate with very little complication rate. So this another patient with a complete long segment occlusion of both sides, right side long segment, left side segmental, It was treated from both sides and stents were placed. This is another patient, stent placed by side, both sides as a kissing stent extending into the aorta. So the once you have treated the all the guidelines, AHA or European guidelines, mention that whenever you have a vascular disease, the first thing you have to correct is the inflow disease. Because doing marvelous job below the inflow will not help. You can improve the outflow, but if there's no blood coming in, it will not be durable. So the inflow has to be managed. If the inflow is aortic, iliac, it has to be managed first. So when you go to infragenicular and infrainguinal disease, the complications become more severe. The disease become more severe, and it can be just a focal or segmental occlusion to complete flush occlusion to a chronic total occlusion extending from the flush femoral artery down to the popliteal artery. But if you look at the pathology, the problem is that when the CTO initially occurs, it's just a thrombus, but gradually it becomes into a large, thick, hard collagen. And it is very difficult to cross that lesion, and that's where the endovascular process comes in. You can do a bypass, you can do a jump bypass, but that jump bypass, once again, has its associated risks of complications and potential risk of the anesthesia and surgery. So there are two ways you can approach that chronic total occlusion, either by intraluminal or subintimal. Subintimal technique, sponsor works or not, I don't know. Okay, let's see. Okay, it's working. It's not working. Okay. If you look at it here, this is what the, on the left side is a classical intraluminal approach. That is probably the preferred approach that we all want to do because the subintimal approach, although very good, but it has its own complications and limitations. The other problem is that intraluminal approach, as I told you, because of fibrous, dense fibrous occlusion is not always possible. So you have to have either an intraluminal approach or a subintimal approach, whichever way the wire goes. Subintimal approach was started by our friend Dr. Aman Bolia, and he has really started this, and nobody believed him when he once started, but now it has become a known and a definitive approach to follow. So what you do is that you go at the edge of the plaque, go dissect it outside the plaque and this intima, and try to go through it. And when you dilate the segment, you have a true lumen. We have a lumen from true lumen to true lumen. In between is the subintimal space. And that's the way to do it. Make a loop, push the loop, go all the way, go back to the true lumen, and you are there. But it's not always easy, because the subintimal technique has its own limitations. You can go in, but you can't go out because of heavily calcified vessels. That's where the re-entry techniques comes in. It has its limitation, especially in heavily calcified arteries, especially when you cannot go back, especially when there are extensive collateral, and you cannot use drug-eluting balloon if you are predominantly subintimal. So we use one of those re-entry devices, which has a needle attached to them. You go into the extraluminal subintimal, pass a guide wire, try to go into the intraluminal, and once you have a through and through access, you can do whatever you want. You want to do angioplasty, you want to put stent, you want to put covered stent. All those endovascular options now are open to you, because the initial challenge is to cross the lesion. The technique is very simple. You just go subintimal. You have to go subintimal first to go to that technique. Once you are subintimal, then you can use this re-entry device, which directs you towards the true lumen. Once you are in the true lumen, you can just dilate your tract and do your definitive treatment. This other case, which was because of heavy calcification, you can see you cannot go in, but we use a re-entry device to go in. Intraluminal approach is the preferred approach because it does not have all those limitations of subintimal approach, but it needs added additional advanced material. One of this is the multiple limits of guide wires, and predominantly the guide wires which are used are hand support catheter, and the predominantly weighted guide wires are used, which are actually have a weight from 5 grams to 40 grams at the tip. And what you do is to tap it to make a small hole into the fibrous cap, and then you try to go through that fibrous cap. There are other CTO devices available, laser, two-pot, crosser. We have used most of them, not all of them, but they all have their limitations and they all have their advantages. TruePath is a crossing device which is actually a rotatory device. It has a tip with diamonds chip attached to it, and you can drill a hole in it. Remember, the CTO is fibrous, but it's very, very thick at the top, because that's where the oldest taut was. So once you have that fibrous cap broken, either by wires, either by those devices, then you have more chance of pushing your wire and going through. Crosser device use a very high frequency vibration, which not only causes, which obviously is such a limited vibration that it does not cause damage to the vessel itself, but it really damages the or cause distraction of the fibrous cap, and then you can work your way out. Laser has been used, but the problem with laser is that when there is a calcified block, then you are limited by it, because that will not work in a calcified block. So once you have crossed him, then you have other options available. The initial challenge is crossing the lesion. Atherectomy or debulking is another choice, that once you have crossed a lesion, you can predominantly safely to be intraluminal, but even if you're subintimal, experienced people are using it, what you do is you take the plaque out. You run this silver hawk, which is a rotatory device, and once you have run it, you can get a true lumen and you get all the plaques in your bottle. So this is another evidence that you can get the plaque out. Once you've got the plaque out, you've got the inciting disease and the initial disease, and then you can use drug-eluting balloon or drug-eluting stent or power stent to maintain the patency. This is another case presented in PCR in which instant stenosis was crossed and then endarterectomized percutaneously, and a covered stent was placed. But you can't declare victory on the way. I mean, we can present you all the good stories, but it's not always that you win. And the most of the situation is when there's a multi-segment disease, when there's SFA occlusion, and there's also below knee occlusion, or below knee stenosis, and you cannot cross from above, then you go back in and go for the Peter approach. If you puncture your, because if you look at this picture, there is a posterior tibial artery patent, so you can puncture that posterior tibial artery, put a small 4-inch sheath and get your excess through, and then you can, once you have crossed that lesion, then you can use balloons to cross and dilate. I mentioned about CTO, that CTO has a thick fibrous cap at top, but distal it is very soft. So what we have learned over the years is that if you go retrogradely in iliac or below knee, you are more likely to cross it intraluminally than you coming from above. This is another patient with chronic total occlusion. We use a pedal excess, got up, snared the wire from above, got an excess through and through, and did an angioplasty. Infragenital disease is probably one of the more severe disease where we need smaller balloons, smaller devices, and more difficult access. But these are the cases, these are the good stories we are all showing you. But there are also unsuccess stories, I must admit. The advantage of the infragenital disease is that an intervention of the infragenital disease is that it has increased. And if you just look at the pictures from 2001 to 2010, this is the US figures predominantly. About 200,000 patients went through revascularization. And if you look at the picture, the blue graph is endovascular and the red graph is surgical. So the endovascular techniques are improving and they are increasing in number, and they provide you enough patency to heal the wound, because perfusion is what we are aiming for. In CLI, remember one thing, it's not the patency, especially in the infragenital disease, that we are aiming for. A lot of people would say, oh, I open the artery, but it closes in like 6 weeks, so it's no use opening. No, It is the perfusion that we are aiming for, and only up to 2 to 6 weeks of perfusion can heal the wound. The studies have shown, look at this figure. The limb salvage rate is about 80% at 3 years, but the primary patency is about 50% over 3 years. So it's not the patency that we are aiming for in CLI, because what we are aiming for is a sustained, short-term, limited, good perfusion to the wound to heal, and that can be provided by endovascular intervention. There's another study which I've shown in 2010, is a meta-analysis, and you see the limb salvage rate is 76%, while the primary rate, potency rate was way back to 33%, yeah, at 12 months. So although the vessels occluded within 6 to 12 months, but they provide enough blood to the wound to be healed. So you see limb salvage, wound healing, and limited amputation, that's what we are aiming for. This is another study, it was a large study of meta-analysis about more than 1,000 patients. The primary potency rates were 33 to 64, but if you look at the rest pain and targeted lesion revascularization, it is up to 76%. So you can provide endovascularly enough flow to the limb for proper healing. So if you look at this study, this was comparing surgery below knee disease. That's where we are in our CLI. Bypass surgery, the bypass surgery is only successful in 2.6% of patients had bypass surgery, and predominantly patients are now getting endovascular intervention. So this study was presented last year, early this year in Ling. We just show the trend that in spite of the fact that we are not getting enough luminal potency, but we are getting enough limb salvage to be more confident of intervention. This another study which shows you that the primary potency as compared to bypass and PTA is way different, but if you look at the limb salvage, it is almost comparable. So the limb salvage rate in interventional using angioplasty is comparable with the bypass surgery, but you need to have an ancillary management of wound management, diabetes management, statins, hypercholesterolemia management, and is a limb support. This is another ischemic calcaneal ulcer which was treated, and we managed to go across into the posterior tibial artery. So we can use smaller balloons, we can have different access to go in, but the primary purpose is to create enough luminal potency to provide the blood flow to have a good result to the wound. Look at that after the angioplasty, you see a good blush at the calcaneum, which shows that the blood flow is going there, and you just have to manage the wound within 2 weeks. Small vessel perfusion can also be. So what is the best treatment? I mean, I don't want to confuse all of you. The best treatment is a mixture of all the treatments, unfortunately. You need to have medical treatment, you need to have endovascular treatment, but you need to have a good wound management, which can be provided by you, by our surgical colleagues. And if all else fails, then you can go for the definite surgical treatment. You have to measure, all patients are not universally managed. They have to be seen in a one-to-one patient specific, because some of the patients will have very low life expectancy or very massive comorbidities, which may not give you the ideal results that the literature present. So this is what a small pathway we have selected, that if the lesion is suitable for angioplasty, go ahead and we'll do angioplasty. If the lesion is moderate, if the patient has a lot of comorbidities, if patient's life expectancy is less than 2 years, we should go in and do an angioplasty. Surgery is only needed when the patient and lesion is suited for angioplasty or percutaneous intervention has failed. And in all these societies are now recommending the endovascular first approach should be applied, and surgery should be maintained limited for those patients where the endovascular options have failed or failed technically or failed to provide the required result. Thank you very much.